Good morning, everyone. Welcome to CSIS and to the third offset conference that we are holding today to talk about what the third offset is, assessing its progress to date, the challenges to going forward, and what may be in store for this issue set that the third offset raises into the future. I'm so pleased to have with us opening the conference today the three of the architects, if you will, of the third offset and its implementation. Collectively, they constitute something you may not have ever heard of called the Advanced Capability and Deterrence Panel. And so I get to be the moderator of the Advanced Capability and Deterrence Panel, speaking today about defining the third offset. So let me begin with brief introductions, and then we're going to have each of our panelists speak a little bit about third offset, and then we'll have a little conversation on how it's defined and how to think about it in terms of how it shapes government activity. All the way to my left is the Honorable Robert Work. He's the Deputy Secretary of Defense. To his right is General Paul Selva, who is the Vice Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And then to my immediate left is Stephanie O'Sullivan, who is the Principal Deputy Director for National Intelligence. Let me begin with the main architect of the third offset strategy. Deputy Secretary Work, I wonder if you can talk to us a little bit about, you know, when you first conceived of framing this issue set around third offset, what is the issue set you were seeking to define in the problem and operational challenge set, and how do you see third offset as a frame being helpful in implementing the department's activities?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank CSIS and Dr. Hamry and Kath for hosting us today. I really appreciate it. And I can't really take credit for the thinking of the third offset. I trace that thinking back to 2012 when Secretary Carter, who was then the Deputy Secretary of Defense, established what is called the Strategic Capabilities Office. And it was motivated by the exact same thinking of what I'll talk about. That was followed by a very important presentation that Secretary Carter gave to the National Security Council on the growing threats and vulnerabilities to our space constellation. And so when I came in, the job of the Deputy Secretary, the primary job, is to fashion a defense program that is in consonant with the Secretary's strategic vision. That's what we do. Paul and I chair what's called the Deputy Management Action Group, and we try to make a cohesive program. So let me tell you what the third offset is all about within the context of fashioning a defense program. It is not a unified field theory. It is focused on one thing and one thing only: conventional deterrence. It is designed to strengthen U.S. conventional deterrence to hopefully avoid ever any major confrontation with any major state. It's focused at what we call the operational level of war. Think of that as the theater level or the campaign level. It's not focused on tactics. It's not focused on specific exchange ratios. It's really focused on having an advantage at the operational level, because from a historical perspective, especially since World War II, having that advantage is the surest way to underwrite conventional deterrence. Now, people always ask us, offset for what? Well, we'll talk about that, I'm sure, in the question and answer period. But the first place you start with is your pacing competitors, the competitors who are developing advanced capabilities. And you want to start your conventional deterrence approach focused on those pacing competitors. And the pacing competitors, not adversaries, the pacing competitors are Russia and China, because they're developing an awful lot of advanced capabilities that potentially worry us. Now, what are we trying to offset? In a case where we are projecting power across the oceans, most of the combat power of the United States is now resident on U.S. territory, either in continental United States or in states outside the continental landmass or in territories. That's different than in the Cold War, when we had a lot of forces forward in the theaters they were expected to fight. The second thing is, offset strategies always happen when our potential competitors reach parity with us in certain areas. And our potential competitors have reached parity with us in what we would term battle networks, theater-wide battle networks. All it is a sensor grid that looks and sees what's happening in the theater, a command, control, communications, and computers, an intelligence grid that tries to make sense of what's happening, and then says what type of effects would we like to achieve. And then you have an effects grid, which then goes out and tries to achieve the effects that the C4I grid has said, let's do it. And then you have a logistics and support grid that keeps the whole thing running. So both China and Russia now have battle networks, theater-wide battle networks, that are approaching parity with us. So to strengthen conventional deterrence, we want to make sure that we can extend our advantage in that particular area. And the third thing is both our pacing competitors have put a lot of money in counter-network operations because they know how powerful our battle networks are. So they spend a lot of money on cyber capabilities, on electronic warfare capabilities, and on counter space capabilities, because our space constellation is a very, very important part of our ability to put these battle networks together. Now, when you hear those three things, not a lot of forces in the theaters they might be expected to fight, guided munitions and battle network parity at the operational level of war, and a lot of counter network operations, the shorthand for that we refer to in the Pentagon is A2AD, Anti-Access Area Denial. It's the shorthand for those three objective facts on the ground. And so what is the offset then? That's what we're trying to offset. We're trying to improve conventional deterrence. And what we believe is the best way to go about this on the initial vector, the initial vector. The third offset doesn't have a destination. This is, as the vice chairman always says, it's a journey. And our initial vector is to exploit all of the advances in artificial intelligence and autonomy, insert them into our battle networks to achieve a step increase in performance that we believe will strengthen conventional deterrence. It's not about technology, however. It's about operational and organizational constructs based on doctrine, based on training, based on exercises that allows the joint force to operate with these type of technologies to achieve an advantage. It's also an institutional strategy. Secretary Carter's going to talk about that a lot in his presentation, about how we're organizing the entire Department of Defense to compete in this new dynamic environment. So I think that's where I'll stop, because I want to get to your questions. But again, the third offset is not a unified field theory. It is focused on one thing and one thing only: strengthening conventional deterrence to make sure wars don't happen.
Great, thank you, General Selva. I wonder if we could get your perspective from the operational and joint combat side in terms of third offset and its value as a frame.
You bet. So I just make a couple of points to expand on what the Secretary's already said. First is the third offset isn't an answer, it's a question. It questions our ability to be able to offset advantages we see emerging in potential competitors' forces. I always describe it as a journey, not a destination. If it were a fixed point in space to which we could all navigate, I would drive those requirements into the Joint Requirements Oversight Council, and I would mandate them in every acquisition program that exists in the department, and I would impose them through the chairman on all of the services. Except it's not an answer, it's a question. And by asking the question, and repeatedly asking the question, what are the advantages that our adversaries are accruing over time? What threats do they pose to our fielded forces? And can addressing those threats strengthen conventional deterrence? I think we're asking the right question. So the way you take technologies and ideas and turn them into tactics, techniques, procedures, and doctrine is through operational experimentation. That begins with designing concepts, testing them in war games, and ultimately testing them in exercises. So from an operational perspective, the journey we're on has the potential to vastly increase the effectiveness of our conventional forces. But we have to ask the right questions. We have to experiment with the right tactics, techniques, and procedures. We have to disseminate those in doctrine to our fielded forces, to our partners, our allies, and our friends, and figure out how to offset this capability that all of our competitors are bringing to the conventional battle space, which is, in simple terms, long-range precision strike at volume. In space, in cyberspace, in the air, on land, and at sea. Now, we can sit back and say, we invented long-range precision strike, and that would be true. But everyone who wishes to compete with us has read our doctrine. They've watched us in battle. They've analyzed our strengths to find asymmetries, and they're reflecting what we're good at right back on us. And so we have to figure out how to offset that in the operational battle space. And I'll stop there because I am really interested in your questions.
Great. So Ms. O'Sullivan, if one thing is not like the others on this panel, you're not a Department of Defense employee. You represent the intelligence community. I'd love to get your perspective from the intelligence community side about how you all have come to be partnered with the Defense Department and how you think about third offset.
So from the moment that the department started talking about third offset, it deeply resonated in the intelligence community. We share a world in which the threats are changing and in which countermeasures are always advancing as well, eroding collectively our national security advantage. So from the time that we deploy a new capability, and increasingly with cyber, from the time we conceive of a new capability, our competitors, I had adversaries, I changed it, our competitors are working to counter that new capability. So in my view, from the IC and for the IC, is that if we are not changing, if we're not driving our own offsets, we are ceding ground. And we are losing our ability to inform policymakers from the Oval Office to warfighters in oval-shaped foxholes, if you will. So I just don't believe, and for the intelligence community in support of the department or any of the policymakers we support, that not changing is an option that we have.
Great, thanks very much. Well, let me, if I can, hope to evoke a little bit of a conversation among you on this topic. Again, you all see each other probably in various venues, but we all don't always get to hear the dialogue that happens, so we hope to get a little piece of that today. Secretary Work, if I could start with you, one of the things some people will say about third offset is all well and good to look at Russia and China, but there are a lot of other issues going on in the world. American public's very concerned, for instance, about ISIS or non-state threats in general, homeland security. There are many, in other words, many other operational challenges out there. What's your response to that in terms of the role third offset plays within the broader defense strategy?
Well, I knew this question was going to come. I didn't know whether it was coming from Kath or from the audience, because this is constantly a question we receive across the department. So I actually have a couple slides. No, ins, ways, and means.
Always good to be the straight man.
Okay. So I'd like you to look at the top part first. When we say we're injecting AI and autonomy into the grids, we're looking at five different things. Autonomous learning systems. These are learning machines that can crunch big data and can see patterns that humans simply cannot see. And they can reveal those patterns to the humans, and they affect the IC. I'm sure Stephanie can talk about that, but they will increasingly impact operations. Human-machine collaborative decision-making is providing fused information, advanced visualization, coupled with machine-to-machine communications with humans being in it, that allow humans to make more timely, relevant decisions. And we refer to that as human-machine collaborative decision-making, with human at the beginning. It's not machine-human collaboration, it is human-machines. Machines using humans to allow them to make better decisions. Assisted human operations, this is providing as much information to the individual in the battle network as possible, that they can pull this information to allow them to make better decisions at every level. And it also is some physical assistance, such as exoskeletons, wearable electronics, disposable sensors right off of the soldier. That's what we mean by assisted human operations. Advanced human-machine combat teaming, you see this all over the place with manned and unmanned systems working together. And the final are network-enabled autonomous weapons and high-speed weapons like directed energy, electromagnetic railguns, and hypersonics. All of those things will be injected into the sensor grid, into the C4I grid, into the effects grid, and the logistics and support grid, allowing a big performance impact. And again, it's not about the technology per se, it's how Paul goes from the JSIDS process, saying here's the requirements, to the doctrine developers who say this is how we will use this, to exercises in the field to train our forces to fight in a new way. That is what we are talking about on the third offset. So people always say, yeah, just like Kath said, well, why are you focused? We're fighting ISIL on a day-to-day basis. Why wouldn't you focus there? Could I have the Yankee slide? This is a whiteboard. This is a whiteboard writing. In the bottom lower right, you'll see YA1. This was a special operator, codename Yankee 1. Came off a mission in 2003. He stacked up his special operators on a specific target, and he said, look, I need to bring the entire power of the battle network to me at this point in time to accomplish this effect on the battlefield. And he sketched out, this is what I need. I need FLIR, forward-looking infrared. I need radar. I need SIGINT. I need IMINT. And I need it all connected, and I need it connected to me. The five areas that we are doing, battle networks are scalable, from micro networks all the way up to the operational level of war. This is completely transferable across the full range of military operations. And let me give you a concrete example. Now, what this is a learning machine that was trained to look across all social media. I mean, all social media. And that is the story of the MH17 shootdown. On the lower left, there's a Twitter shot of MH17 taking off. The next one comes from ParisMatch.com. It is the picture of the Russian SA-11 launcher with a serial number on it, date and time stamped, near the village where the shootdown occurred. Then on Bellingcat.com, exact same SA-11, exact same serial number, in the very same location. Then there's a Twitter shot of a contrail of a missile rising at the time of the shootdown. Then a rebel leader takes credit for the shootdown on VK.com. That was immediately taken down, by the way. And finally, on YouTube, there's a picture of the exact same SA-11 with a missile rail that is now mysteriously empty going back into Russia. Learning machines did this without any human interaction. If we had had this capability at the time of the MH-11 shootdown, we would have been able to prove, in my view, that this truly was a Russian missile provided to the separatists in eastern Ukraine, and they were responsible for the shootdown. This type of stuff will allow us new indications and warning in gray zone operations, the little green men. Learning machines can say there is an influence operation going on. We don't know who is doing it, but here are the key themes of the influence operations. So there will be new means of I&W. There will be new means of going after terrorists. There will be new means of operating against regional powers. There'll be new ways of operating against great state powers. This is totally transferable across the range of operations.
Anyone else want to comment on that before I go on?
Let me give you a simple example, because everybody pushes back on this notion of AI and algorithms helping us do what we do better. And it's not a military example. I'm a horrible guitar player. but I play my guitar every night for an hour. Do you know there's an app that can take an algorithm and decode a song and give you the chord progressions and let you play along with the band? So my wife's new favorite party trick is to pull the app out, hand me my guitar, pick the title of a song I've never heard before, and ask me to play it for dinner guests, which is a little bit of torture for them. It's always a surprise for me, but what's interesting is this algorithm is 90% accurate at picking out the chord progressions on any song you put into your computer. It makes me better at what I do. All of you, sometime today, will interact with a piece of artificial intelligence that makes you do something a little faster, a little better, a little more efficiently. We have not, to this point, harnessed the capability of that part of our IT inventive and innovative community and applied it to broad military problems. We have in very narrow spaces. And part of what we're trying to do with this question that we're asking about the potential for a third offset is to simply plant that question in the minds of the people that work for us. Is there a better way? And if there's a better way, can you assist that operation by taking your intellectual effort and putting where it is most value added and letting machines do the rudimentary work for you? And I think there's great promise in that space, but we have to be willing to take that step.
So as the DepSec pointed out, and you just illustrated, we're all swimming in a sea of information, and our analysts in the IC are charged with pulling out from that sea of information indications and warnings in a world that has, where pervasive instability sort of feels to have become the norm. And what these learning machines and capabilities allow us to do is to see patterns, to do sense making, movement and imagery, to pull out triage documents or things in foreign languages so that you can rapidly pull out the key pieces of information, or to see patterns that weren't there before in all source information when you add it all up. And above all, then it would allow us to also enhance our tradecraft, allow us to look at alternative hypotheses and analyses so that we don't get so that we pursue that intelligence holy grail of not having bias in the analysis and assessments that we present.
Mr. Solomon, I think one of the other things that often comes up is this idea of the Achilles heel, our strengths, our weaknesses. You know, everything in life can be a Greek tragedy. The more we are information enabled, the more we are, of course, reliant, therefore, on those information systems. We've had recent cases where the IC has come together to say, for instance, in this one most recent case, that the Russians are responsible for hacking. We've had North Korean hacking, things like that before. Obviously, for an operator in the battle space, this is a real concern that the military deals with routinely. How do you approach this issue from an intelligence community perspective about the degree to which you can leverage artificial intelligence to enable everything that you do, while recognizing the challenges it can pose because it could be exploited?
Well, I have a technology background, and one thing I've known from the beginning when I first started working in the intelligence community is that all technology is a double-edged sword. Mm-hmm. It's both an opportunity and a challenge. All of these things that we're talking about can present new opportunities. We've been talking a lot about genome biology, advances in biology, and the fact that that could make huge advances for humankind. It also poses in unscrupulous hands immense challenges for societies. And basically what's really hard for us in the business of warning about threats and what's going to happen in the world is that technology is changing so fast that it's challenging and stressing governments and our society's ability to adapt to the changes it's bringing. And that's part of what's driving this mm-hmm. pervasive instability I was talking about. So when we look at every single new capability, it's with both sides. It's here's how you can use this technology to advance our capabilities, and here's what it's going to mean as a challenge to us, whether it's a direct confrontation by competitors, or just what it means to a government's ability to handle the change that it's bringing.
Mm-hmm. Secretary Work, you wanted to comment?
From an operational perspective, we worry about this all the time, too. Mm-hmm. The best example I have is in wargaming, over a long period of time, kind of two schools of thought developed. One school of thought says, look, your adversary is going to try to break up your network. It's going to try to sever the connections within the network. It's going to try to blind the network. And so we take that as a fact. All of our exercises now are starting to inject what happens if you lose global prepositioning system data, GPS data. What happens if your communications links are severed? What do you do? We're training on this all the time. But there were two schools of thought that developed. One was, look, you have to fight to keep your network intact. You have to try to keep all the connections there, and you really have to work on the network. And then there was another school that says, fool's game. The network will dissemble under attack. And what you have to do is train your force to be able to operate with thin line communications and thin connections between the force. And so that second school of thought is the way that animates us operationally. And that's why we're training the force. And I know we'll get there, but that's one of our key advantages. Our assumption is that a young man or woman who grows up in a democracy in the I world will have an inherent advantage over young men and women who grow up in an authoritarian regime. Because we expect the network to dissemble, and we rely on our people under mission-type command to continue to operate. That's how we train the force from top to bottom. So we believe this is a very, very big advantage for us.
Let me give you a current operational example. Two forces use the same kind of data links to do two different things. In Western military forces, generally we use data links to network the force and allow people to see across that network what everybody else sees. And so that broad view of the battle space allows our forces to collaborate and maneuver together. In a country that shall not be named, data links are used to issue orders to individuals. So central leadership, believing that they have the best view of the battle space, issues individual orders to individual portions of the maneuver element using a similar system of data links. And so in the case of the Western network, it actually degrades gracefully. In the case of the competitor network, if you can shut down the network, their forces don't know what to do because they are conditioned to react to orders. And so when you talk about the networks that we might build into the future and the dependencies on vast arrays of data that move through those networks, we have to attend to the resiliency of the network and the resiliency of the force that subscribes to the network. And so when we exercise without the precision navigation and timing of GPS, or without the connectivity of the network element to element, We're exercising the independence of the maneuver elements within that force. Typically, that does not happen in authoritarian organizations that believe that central leadership and central command is an absolute. Now, can they adapt? Of course they could adapt. We better adapt faster than they do. And so part of the requirement that we see going into the future for these kinds of networks is both accessibility for our force and resiliency against attack. And then the third part of that discussion is, in the absence of the network, that resilient force has to actually disassemble and continue to operate. And so we're going to work that.
General Selva, you've hit on something that's come up, Secretary Work's comments as well, which is how you institutionalize this, the cultural underpinning, the training, the doctrine, the experimentation, the exercises. The department has a rich history, some very good examples, some maybe that didn't seem to pan out in terms of trying to drive innovation, particularly from the center. And then examples, of course, of innovation arising, if you will, from the bottom up. What's your assessment of how well the department today is organized and acculturated to innovation as a challenge set for the future? And if there are major areas where you think there is places where the department could do better, it'd be great to hear about that.
So as a general principle, I would propose to you that we're not organized for innovation.
Yeah.
And now I'm going to refute that proposition a little bit. So where our organization, the entire organization, and that is every part of the government that reacts to national security threats, is in fact organized to innovate, is when we see a compelling threat, when we see a change in the dynamic between the competitors who might become adversaries and our current state of play. And we have identified that a threat to our ability to prevail in the battle space that threatens the stability of conventional deterrence. We've already talked about it. It's long-range precision strike at volume. It's countries that would counter our ability to project power in an effort to preserve their view of their influence over their near abroad. And that means holding us out of the Pacific. It means moving us to the far reaches of Western Europe so that we can't defend our NATO allies. And those are conditions we cannot allow to come to pass. And so when we see a common threat, we all move to figure out how to defeat it. And so in that respect, we are in fact organized to innovate. What we don't do is innovation on a micro scale. Innovation on a micro scale happens in industry every day. It's healthy. It's how industry makes step function changes in the services and the capabilities that they bring to us in the commercial market. I've used this analogy in this room. It's like a brush fire in nature. It burns out all the underbrush, it fertilizes the ground, and good things sprout and grow. In something as important as national defense and national security, innovation is treated like a forest fire. We bring out the fire brigades and we put it out, because innovation on a micro level tends to threaten institutions. And so part of what we've been able to do, the three of us as the Advanced Concepts and Deterrence Panel, is actually reach very deep down into the services and find common cause in this particular threat. And we have all of the doctrine development centers and all of the wargaming laboratories in the services spending a portion of their energy trying to decompose this problem and come up with new ideas. And we've even put money behind it. So we have a wargaming incentive fund, and we have a war fighting laboratory innovation incentive fund, and we provide grants to the services when they're ready to do experiments and when they're ready to do innovative war games. And so I think we have organized to innovate, but I will continue with my pitch that at a micro level, innovation can be a little bit unsettling for us, but at a macro level, at a strategic level, when we're looking out into the future, our military shown, our defense enterprise has shown that we're incredibly innovative, and we just have to reach for that spirit.
Well, I want to give a shout out to my uniformed battle buddy here, because a lot of time when we talk innovation, we're talking about technology and how fast we can exploit or develop a technology. But the third offset is all about operational and organizational innovation. In 1975, the U.S. Army said, we are going to own the night. We are going to complete the entire transition of our force to operate 24/7, 365, to maintain a high operational tempo and press the enemy 24 hours a day. Now, in 1975, anybody could have bought night vision goggles. They were kind of clunky, they were heavy, they weren't all that great. But it wasn't the night vision goggles. That was just enabling the Army to get to owning the night. It was all the tactics, techniques, and procedures to allow the squad leaders to control a squad quietly at night. It was the company commanders and the battalion commanders. And in 10 years, the Army owned the night. So The innovation that I look for in the third offset is not how fast, again, someone can get a specific innovation into the fight. That's easy. But having the operators trust that innovation and knowing how to employ it is the key. And that is where we really do, I think, are pretty darn good at operational and organizational innovation.
So I completely agree that it's not just technology, it's also how you operate things. So you could argue that for the intelligence community, one of the first offsets was the overhead constellation and the tremendous insight that that brought to our policymakers and warfighters, having that initial capability and constellation of satellites that were put up. We evolved a way of tasking those satellites that was very much based on how precious they were. And we competed and we had much debated targeting decks. But what technology is giving us today and the new tactic that we need to embrace is how we can do tipping and queuing via automated talking between across the constellation. And we can get much more capacity out of that which we already have than we do today. But we need to embrace the change in the way that we allocate those resources, which is a cultural and a bit of a challenging change for us.
Well, what I'd like to do now is open it up to the audience for some questions. Let me give you some rules of the road. There'll be a microphone that comes around when I call on you. We'd like to hear your name and your affiliation if you have one. And the most important rules always involve the question itself. The first is, it should be a question, not a statement, and short. And the second is, it should be on topic. We purposely pulled this day together to have a focus on third offset and the issues around it, and I'm gonna just move to the next questioner if it's on a different topic. So with that, please raise your hands if you have a question you'd like to ask. I have one right here.
Jeff Bialos, I'm a partner at a law firm. First of all, let me congratulate you all on the DII and the focus in particular on bringing technology to the warfighter, which I think has been well overdue with the department. Secretary Work, one of the key premises of the third offset is that technology has proliferated and has essentially eroded our prior offsets and allowed our adversaries to take advantage of some of the innovations we brought. In that context, what is the basis to assert that autonomy, a technology that looks to me like it's going to be pretty ubiquitous, could conceivably be the basis for our next offset? All you have to do is go test drive a Tesla, and you'll see autonomy. I mean, today Elon Musk has an offset. I don't mean to be glib, but the point is, and I understand how autonomy certainly would be one investment and one element of a future force, but what's the basis to say we're going to get any kind of a sustained overmatch based on that?
Well, first, I'll start with your last point. We are not arguing that we will have a sustained overmatch. This is a very dynamic environment. Two examples: the rifle, telegraph, and railroad revolution and war. This AI and autonomy are very much like railroads and telegraphs. They were being driven by the commercial sector. It changed our society. And as a result, it inevitably changed the character, not the nature of war. AI and autonomy is changing all of our lives. As the vice chairman said, at an astounding rate. It's happening so fast that sometimes we don't even notice it. So this is going to be a world of fast followers. And what we have said, Jeff, again, is it's not so much AI and autonomy. It's injecting it into our battle networks and allowing our battle nets to work better than our potential competitors. And we believe we do have an advantage in AI and autonomy on the operational level of war at this time. We think we might be able to have an advantage for some time if we move to operational or organizational constructs, but we are organizing ourselves temporally, saying we may only have an advantage for 5 years, and so you better be thinking about the advantage you want to create in the next 5 years and the year after that. We're thinking much more like a competitive business where the market is constantly changing and you're having to adapt. So, again, we know that AI and autonomy will vastly improve the power of our battle networks. We know that our competitors will probably conclude the same thing. In a world of fast followers, as long as you're a fast leader, you have an advantage. But you always have to be thinking about what happens when we achieve parity, what's the next step.
I also think we need a broader view of what autonomy is, just to pick on your point of cars that can drive themselves. That's interesting, but it barely scratches the surface of what could happen if every car was part of a network. If every vehicle on the road subscribed to a network that optimized our traffic, my guys wouldn't have had to go to lights and sirens to get here on time.
I will say that Washington traffic is the best anti-access area denial network in the world.
The reason I pick on that point a little bit is, having spent a lot of time with people who think critically about artificial intelligence and autonomous automation, every one of them would tell you that we are barely scratching the surface. We are now only beginning to learn the promise of these potential technologies for the future. And that's why I say this is a question, not an answer. If we lock into systems that are not adaptive, that can't continue to bring in new information and new networks, if we don't truly build resilient open architectures, then what we'll doom ourselves to is a fleet of singular autonomous things. And we won't be able to adapt. And so at the heart of your question is, of course autonomy is going to evolve over time. And we have to evolve with it. The current advantage we have in the battle space is born of technologies that are 40 years old. Born of ops concepts, tactics, techniques, and procedures, while they have evolved, are largely 40 years old. We're not going to be able to sustain any kind of advantage over potential competitors in an environment where software, applications, and machines allow organizations to adapt quickly. And so we really have to get to the heart of your question and sort out how deeply we're going to look into this problem, how far we're going to predict what our capabilities are going to be, and how adaptive we can make the architecture. For those of you in industry that are in this room, I can't tell you how many times I've asked the following question. Will your widget subscribe to an open architecture? Answer is always, oh, sir, of course. Because the JROC says we have to have open architecture, so we built an open architecture. I say, wonderful, here's an application I would like you to put into your widget to make it more useful to the military, to the service that ordered it. Oh, sir, we can't do that. It is an open architecture, but only inside of our company. Or only inside of our proprietary IP that's in the system. We really have to unlock the potential. And the only way we can do that for AI and autonomy is to find a resilient open architecture to which all of our systems can subscribe. And we've only scratched the surface on that as well.
I just reinforced that by saying that asking that question is like asking the question in the Wayback Machine when ARPANET first came out. Well, this is kind of interesting, you know, but what's this going to do for us? And we're right at the beginning, and we really can't see all the possible places that it can take us. But we know that we need to remove the barriers to allow it to be explored. And to do that, I guess the Valley calls it fast failure, but for us, it's the fast learning. See what this thing could mean, explore it, and then move on if it doesn't, you know, if it's the brush that should have burned down.
Great. Okay, next question. I have one right here in the middle. There's a mic coming, hopefully.
Thank you. Dr. Ted Johnson from the Deloitte Center for Government Insights. My question is, the first offset was accompanied by, basically benefited from the National Security Act of 47, the second from Goldwater-Nichols reform. What's the statutory reorg coming that will help realize all the advantages in the third offset?
I don't actually think we have to reorg to do this. And I would challenge your premise. I hate to do that in a group that's this bright, because I'm not the brightest guy in the room. But those offsets were not just the product of changing our national security policy apparatus. In fact, the policy apparatus changes may actually have been a result of the things that were happening around us. So I would suggest to you that a big part of the first offset was the fact that we found a relatively inexpensive way to miniaturize nuclear weapons and allow them to be used across the breadth and depth of the battle space. That actually posed some very serious questions for our national security leadership. In the mid-70s, we realized that precision would get us to a different equation in that same battle space. And by the way, some of our competitors say we create nuclear effects with conventional weapons because of our precision. That is so wrong. We create the operational outcomes with precision munitions that our competitors ascribed to nuclear weapons. There's a huge difference in the way you say that and what it means. That means we don't have to deploy all of that firepower in the battle space in that configuration. And by the way, it wasn't just precision. It was stealth, precision, and a sensor network that gave us indications and warning to make that capacity useful in the battle space. And we reorganized around it. Those were the seeds of airland battle. We reorganized concepts around it. We didn't reorganize our services around it. And so the compelling issue with Goldwater Nichols was we had these services that were very, very capable of working together, and we didn't have an organizational construct to encourage that. And so Goldwater Nichols was born. I don't think we're making that big a shift in what we're doing that causes us to have to reorganize the national security apparatus of the nation. Are there places where we can trim and tweak on the edges? Yes, but last night I found myself describing the Defense Department as a diamond. It's already been cut. If you polish it, all you can do is make it brighter. And what we're doing right now is polishing the diamond.
Okay, we have a question right back here.
Hans Christian Hagman from the Swedish Ministry of Foreign Affairs. First of all, thanks to CSIS for arranging this outstanding discussion. Where do allies and partners fit into this equation? And how do we solve long-term interoperability without giving away the goodies to the potential competitors? Thank you.
And I will just free advertise to say we have a whole panel on allies and partners today. We welcome your guidance to that panel.
Yeah, we have many of our close allies here, Norway, the United Kingdom, Japan. There are many others, and this is what we would say. In addition, the first advantage we believe we have, the competitive advantage, going back to the AI question in this world, is we believe our people, within the framework of what we're trying to accomplish, provide us an enormous competitive advantage. Second thing was talked to by Paul, jointness. Jointness is hard. It takes all of the Western armies and our armed forces to a greater or lesser degree are going more towards joint solutions. Why? Because your battle network, if you have discrete functional networks, it will never operate as well as a cohesive joint network. So we've 30 years since Goldwater Nichols, so we've got a lot of play, and our competitors are trying to copy us in this regard. And the third thing you hit on is our allies. Allied battle. We believe in our national security strategies that alliances are absolutely central to not only our security and our partner security, but to global security. If you compare us with our potential pacing competitors, they don't have a lot of allies. We do. So from the very beginning, we have been talking with our partners and our allies about how we work this together. And the way we describe the third offset is it's very coalition friendly. In the second offset, the coin of the realm was a mechanized infantry battalion, or an armored division, or a heavy artillery battalion. Now, anybody can come up with an application in AI or autonomy in any one of the domains, cyberspace, air, space, on the sea, under the sea, and it improves the power of the entire network. So this is very coalition friendly. We're thinking of it from the very beginning as interoperable, exchanging data, machine-to-machine discussions. And so far, all of our discussions have been very, very, very fruitful.
Intelligence sharing is such an important piece of this. I wonder if you can address that.
Well, clearly, we're in the midst of what Director Clapper brought to the IC, which is integration. And I would argue that that's our current offset. Integrating all the pieces that we have, fully leveraging that which we have, and deepening our work with partners is foundational, I think, to an advantage that we have gained, that we can pull together what we already know. Now, as far as the risks involved, sure. But it just requires the additional work to think about what we're sharing. It's not a open kimono everything. That's foolish. But it's thoughtfully engaging in how can we best leverage and help each other. And we're doing all this structural work to make that possible. And I won't go into the details, but it's largely in the way that we're structuring our IT system so that we know what we have, it's tagged and labeled, and we can therefore more easily share it.
Great. Okay, other questions? All the way over here, let's see, there's a young lady in the second row back, I think. Yes.
Good morning. Thank you again to the panel. Trish Martinelli from the Office of Naval Intelligence, Nimitz Ops Intel Center. So there are a lot of pieces to the puzzle that you're putting together regarding innovation and advances in the Defense Department. And some of the challenges that I've observed in a resource-constrained environment is how you articulate your return on investment to doing better or to doing faster or to doing an increased level of fidelity with the data points that you have. So how do you articulate return on investment now? And how do you keep kind of the wind at your back when the Pentagon doesn't actually have a competitor where the warfighter can go for a different level of service if they're not getting what they need?
I think you'll hear from Secretary Carter in just a few minutes on how he has tackled this problem as far as the entire innovation agenda within the department. But let me just say, the way we will determine return on investment is through the operators. The second offset took life when the Army and the Air Force got together and conceived of air-land battle, which employed the technologies. And within a very short period of time, by 1984, the Soviet General Staff said, this is completely unhinged the way we were thinking about the fight. So what we will do, Paul talked about a war gaming incentive fund, where we incentivize to look at new concepts which bring in these technologically abled operational constructs. And they will say, wow, there looks like a big operational return on investment if we do this. Then we incentivize the concept developers and the doctrine developers to develop it further. And then we do exercises. And it will be the feedback from this loop on how it improves the performance of the joint force that will tell us the return on investment to tell us we really should go this way. We are making modest investments, a lot of levers, a lot of tests, a lot of demonstrations. As I've stole Paul's line, this is a journey, it's not a destination. And so the return on investment for us is going to be when the Army, the Marines, the Navy, and the Air Force and our allies and our special operators come back to us and say, this is the real deal. And that's where we'll start to really pour our money.
This is about the force taking ownership of the question. I'm very, very, very suspect of hard, objective criteria that we can advertise as success. And I'll just make up an example, and you can push back if you want. DDG 1000 is an incredible ship. She's stealthy, she's smart, she's networked, she's resilient, and she's 10 times more lethal than any competitor's ship of the same class. To which somebody who just crunches numbers for a living would say, well, then you wanted 20, so two will do. We have a history in the department, in the services, of taking the subjective outcomes of war games before the services and our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and marines have taken ownership of the tactics, techniques, procedures, and doctrine, and advertised them as success. And it hasn't been fruitful. So my view is, I think, the same as the secretary's. When I have soldiers, sailors, airmen, and marines echoing back to me that in their workspaces, in their units, in their maneuver elements, they are seeing the benefit of this kind of thinking, then we win. And that's where the return on investment comes from. Because we can experiment and knit things together in different ways. It'll be viewed as a bright idea unless it makes a difference on the deck plates. And that's where we have to go. And so I would use the same measure. When we have articles in our professional journals, when we have commanders responding, when we have the doctrine centers and the wargaming centers actually putting together exercises and bringing us the ideas of those young men and women who serve in uniform, that's the return on investment.
And the best example of this is we would not have GPS today had Bill Perry and Harold Brown listened to what is now called CAPE, was then called PA&E. PA&E said, the return on investment on the GPS, it's hard for us to calculate, and therefore you ought to kill it. Well, it just so happened that Bill Perry was in a helicopter, and he was in the middle of a kind of really dicey whiteout, brownout type situation, and that helicopter just happened to have an experimental, what was then called, it wasn't called GPS at the time. And the pilot landed, and Perry asked him, he said, I did it all by GPS. So what is the return on investment of being able to time sync an entire battle network at the theater scale? What's the return on investment on that? It's hard for us to tell you. But when we get into operations like Desert Storm and we say, whoa, being able to time sync everybody and being able to do guided munitions attack 24/7 through the weather, how do you, you know, the return on investment is, as Paul said, when the theater commanders come to us and say, this is how we will win in the future. So we have to be careful not to say, I just don't know if you're going to get a six by return on investment on this. It's all about operational and organizational constructs.
I'm afraid we're going to have to make that the last word. This has been an incredibly interesting and helpful panel in helping to frame up the rest of the day. We do have Secretary Carter following this, so after I thank the panel formally, I'm going to ask that everyone stay where they are and not get up and go get coffee or anything, but we will switch over very quickly here. But I do want to thank Secretary of War General Selva, Ms. O'Sullivan, for taking time out of their very busy calendars today to come here and help frame up for us what we hope will be a very fruitful discussion about the way ahead on Third Offset. So please join me in a round of applause for our panel.